Welcome to Increasing Philanthropy's Commitment to Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion. If there's anything we can do to make your experience more comfortable, please raise your hand or speak to a Dance NYC staff or volunteer. You'll see them stationed around the room in the black I Am a New Yorker for Dance t-shirts. We invite you to download our symposium app. If you haven't already, search Hello Crowd on the App Store and search Dance NYC 2017 Symposium. In your tote bags, you'll also find several cards that ask for your suggestions for the NYC Cultural Plan. Throughout the day, as you navigate sessions and have ideas, please write them on your card and deposit them on boxes throughout the space or with any of the volunteers that you see around. A friendly reminder, you are on camera. Sessions that are filmed and photographed for archival purposes. And that's also why in Q&A, we will pass around a microphone for you so that for those people watching on a simulcast or at home, we'll be able to hear your questions. If you do not wish to be captured in photography, please sit in the no photography area of the room, which can be found in the back row. Don't all rush at once. The next conversation will spotlight a distinguished panel of funders advancing diversity, equity, and inclusion within their philanthropic institutions. We'll discuss their approach and explore emerging trends, lessons learned, and their long view regarding anticipated impacts as a result of DEI expanding in the community. Please join me in welcoming our wonderful moderator, Lisa Yancey, Organizational Development Consultant for Yancey Consulting.
Thank you very much. Wow, this is like a homecoming. I'm seeing faces and people I haven't seen in a very long time. I'm really thrilled and honored to be here today and to facilitate this conversation. So we're going to jump right in because we have quite an agenda to share with you. I'm going to start by doing a very brief introduction. I'm Lisa Yancey. To my left, I have Ella Baff. Ella Baff is the Senior Program Officer for Arts and Heritage at the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation. To my right, I have Hoong Lee Krakauer, the Executive Director for Queens Council on the Arts. To her right, I have Maurine Knighton, who is the Program Director for the Arts at Doris Duke Charitable Foundation. And then holding up the far right, I have the lovely Sage Crump, who is a Program Specialist for the National Performing Arts Network. The flow of the day. So we're going to start by having a conversation where each of the panelists will define for you how they see diversity, equity, and inclusion, and give some examples of how it shows up in their work. After that, we're going to lead into a conversation around some bright spots, looking at the field. What's happening with DEI? Or what are these statistics that's coming up right now, and what does that mean for the future, both for the field at large and the dance community? After that, we'll talk about the changing landscape implications. Each person will have something to share on that. And then we're going to open it up for the audience to ask some questions. Now, when I open it up for the audience to ask the questions, we're going to have very succinct questions, not succinct, because I'm going to be minding the time, because that is my job today. And you're going to say exactly what your question is. You're going to keep it to 1 minute in getting it out. So that we can have the best opportunity for the most questions during that segment. And then finally, as a part of our interactive discussion, each of the panelists will ask you a question, and one audience member will be selected to answer. Cool? All right, awesome. So one thing about me, silence does not mean consent. So when I ask a question, if you respond verbally, then I know we're all on the same page. So we're good?
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay. So with that, I'm going to jump into the first question. And regarding what's happening with DEI, let's first hear how or if each of the panelists distinguishes the word diversity, equity, and inclusion. And if they do, what does it mean and how does it show up in the work? And I'm going to start on my left with Ella.
Thank you very much. I want to make sure you can all hear me. I think you can, yes?
Yes.
Hi. Hello, everyone. It's nice.
No,
not really.
Now.
Better?
Yes.
Okay. It's nice to almost see you. How do we define the differences among diversity, inclusion, and equity? I think the easier one is maybe diversity. In plain English, of course, it means many. And it celebrates, and I will use that word intentionally, group or individual differences, whether it's race, gender identity, ethnicity, class, and so on. Now, for inclusion and equity, I'm actually going to read something because I think every word should be said. Inclusion, the active, intentional, ongoing engagement with diversity to increase awareness and empathy for the many complex ways in which people, systems, and institutions interact. And for equity, it's the creation of opportunities for historically underrepresented sectors, organizations, and people to balance the scales of power, access, knowledge, and you can probably add a whole bunch of other things to that. I think when you see the slide here, I should say all of that seems to add up to cultural competence in which we see the world in a mutually beneficial and shared way. When you see, this is just a quick snapshot of what we did in 2016 at the foundation, and the dollars I think speak for, you know, we tried to put our money where our heads are. And we have five programs at the foundation. And this is what we did in grants that were more specifically directed towards diversity and equity and inclusion initiatives. I must say that at the foundation, these values and practices really thread throughout everything we do. So it was actually a little bit hard for us to tease it out in this way, but we did. And then you see the grand total. And then we also have in our applications language on diversity and inclusion in the guidelines so that people can address that question specifically in their own authentic way for their organization. Did you want to hear about a couple of things, or should we wait for that?
You can share one. That would be great.
Okay. Well, or should I? I'll wait.
Okay. So, Hoong-Yi, would you share how you distinguish diversity, equity, and inclusion?
I'd be happy. Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes.
Okay. Can I? Do you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, great. The Queens Council on the Arts is located in a very diverse borough, and I could speak to you about how we do our grant making, which I think addresses cultural equity, diversity, and inclusion in a way that's almost relentless, because just by nature of being located in this borough, we do have diverse pools of artists and art makers. But I really wanted to tell you about something that I do for the nonprofit coordinating committee, because I think that that addresses DEI in a way that really can help all of you in terms of your own organizations. For those of you who don't know, the nonprofit coordinating committee used to have a partnership with the New York Times Foundation, and they awarded the Nonprofit Excellence Awards in Management. Now it is funded by the Clark Foundation and the New York Community Trust. They are based on seven areas of expertise, which include human resources, technology, etc. And they recently added, in the last 2 years that I've been a panelist, a diversity area of excellence, and are determining what constitutes excellent practice in those areas for nonprofit management. And the facts and the data from all of the grantees that we have awarded for the last 6 years that I've been participant or involved with this reflect a lot of the data that was shared in previous panels today at this conference. Very, very little diversity at the top, a lot of diversity on the bottom at the entry level. So how do we create the situation at the top where the diversity can be inclusive and in a way that is resonant with the mission of the organizations, and yet create a standard of excellence that can be used for all nonprofits in the field to aspire to? The work has been very grueling, to tell you the truth. It's one of the least developed areas of that grant panel. And yet, I'm very optimistic that there are some great minds, and I've been fortunate to have worked with them on these grant panels and to be participant in the kinds of conversations that are going on. So I will share with you the one practice that I thought was really interesting, because we are in a dance space, and I really think that one of the speakers in a prior panel had said that when you think about talking about diversity and you sit and talk, it's a very sedentary activity. Like, you sit there and somebody else sits there and you just talk. But once you get something into movement and you incorporate into your body, you have a different kind of learning. So one of the winners of the Excellence Awards 2 years ago, not surprisingly, the executive director was a dancer. And she instituted a diversity walk to inaugurate every board meeting. And it was great. Yeah. And so awesome. This way she made them actually get up and do this walk, and the questions for this particular organization were very, very relevant, and I'll share one of them with you. One of the questions I thought was interesting was, how many of you grew up in a house where the staircase was on the outside of the door? And from 1 to 10, you had to just sit or stand where you were, and then you had to keep silent for a minute and just look. And so what that did was, it embodied where your privilege is, and then it embodied where your peers' privilege was, and then it invited you to reflect upon that. No right, no wrong, but just that's what it was. And they did that for 10 questions. And so, as you can imagine, the board meeting discussions after that particular exercise, after they moved and it sort of embodied all this, were very different. And so, not surprisingly, that was one of the practices that we awarded this particular group for, because they understood that kinesthetic learning component. So I wanted to share that with you just to let you know that there are some great practices that are being developed on that level, in addition to all of the practices or work that is being conducted by members of our field as well. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Hoon Yi. As a former dancer and choreographer, I like the idea of kinetic equity, the kinesthesiology of diversity. I love that. Now I'd like to pass it to Maurine Knighton.
Good afternoon, everyone. I have a couple of slides for you. We have limited time, as our moderator has already pointed out, so I might talk really quickly, but I'm going to try to be clear, and if you don't understand me, you can just read the slides. So it'll all work out. So today, actually, I'm going to be speaking to you wearing two hats. First, of course, that of Program Director for the Arts at the Doris Duke Charitable Foundation, but I actually also serve on the board of Grantmakers in the Arts and the chair of its Racial Equity Committee, which has been a committee of the board for a few years now, so I've been directing that work there. So I'm going to start because I want to talk with GIA, because I want to talk a little bit about where the field of arts philanthropy is moving. Oh. That way for that, this way to look and be sure that it happened. Okay, got it. So GIA has articulated a specific statement of purpose around funding, and that is to increase arts funding for ALANA, which you've heard a lot today, African, Latinx, Asian, Arab, and Native American artists, arts organizations, children, and adults. Now, we also want to acknowledge that our society is challenged to overcome a complex web of inequities, not just racial inequity, but in fact also sexism, homophobia, classism, and ableism, among a group of others. And all of these are powerful drivers of unequal outcomes for individuals and groups. But it is GIA's belief that ALANA individuals whose identities intersect with those of these other quote-unquote minority social statuses often experience compounded mistreatment that is exacerbated by the interaction of race. And therefore, GIA has decided it has to focus in order to be most effective and have greatest impact. And we are starting with racial equity in our work, although we are very interested in intersectionality with work going on in other forms of injustice. So at the end of the day, we're really interested in working against racial inequity by working toward racial equity in arts philanthropy. And we've defined racial equity in arts philanthropy as being involved with philanthropists who consider root causes and systems to understand historic inequities in funding. So what's embedded there is the notion of corrective action. So not just starting from where we are, but understanding the systems and structures that have gotten to where we are today, and being able to extrapolate from there the idea that if you didn't start at the same place, whatever you do today will likely not take you to the same destination. So in terms of definitions, both GIA and DDCF have adopted the definitions that were put together by independent sector. And we do distinguish among diversity, equity, and inclusion. For us, diversity includes all of the ways in which people differ, and you'll hear this word differ a few times, encompassing the different characteristics that make one individual or group different or distinct from another. Now, as for inclusion, that is the act of creating environments in which any individual or group can be welcome and feel welcomed, respected, supported, and valued to fully participate. Equity, then, is the fair treatment, access, opportunity, and advancement for all people, while at the same time striving to identify and eliminate barriers that have prevented the full participation of some groups. And I'll end with a statement from another organization whose work I admire a great deal, and that is an organization called Race Forward. In answer to the notion of how racial equity might look, they say that they envision a vibrant world in which people of all races create, share, and enjoy resources and relationships equitably, unleashing individual potential, embracing collective responsibility, and generating global prosperity. So here, I just want to land with a URL for the website for GIA, which has a great number of resources. Well, it was
you can
there.
Get that. Yeah. We'll get it to you. We'll get it to you.
Yeah, you'll see. But GIA's website has a number of resources around its work in particular on racial equity, as well as can point you in directions to enhance your own work and understanding.
So Sage, as a program specialist, which means there is deep subject matter expertise, can you continue to unravel the nuances around diversity, equity, and inclusion, please?
I think I can, Lisa. primarily because the program I run for the National Performance Network is called LANE. And LANE stands for Leveraging a Network for Equity. And we're very specific about equity and what that means. When I think about, and it's always difficult following Maurine, because sometimes we think alike so much, so I'm going to try not to repeat anything, but one of the things I think is important around the definition of equity is the understanding of history, and that back to where we are now, this just didn't appear. But there's a historical context to the time period in which we're in, and so if we're looking at inequity and we're looking at injustice and oppression, it's important to look at the arc of history, both within the field and in the social context in which we live, in order to create program solution strategies that actually get to the root cause. When we were developing LANE, we thought a lot about the work of Ella Baker and radical movements, and radical really meaning getting back to the root cause. And so we take a systems approach, looking at, we want healthy organizations, but we also want a healthy network and we want a healthy ecosystem. And in order to do that, given the history that exists, it means flattening power structures, right? So one of the ways we enact that within LANE and with our program and in our organization is that we have a set of what we call cornerstones. There are four ways that we believe if we embody these four things in all we do, from what hotels we choose to who's on our panels to what cities we go visit, then we are both practicing equity for ourselves and also supporting equitable ideas for who we fund and who we support. What's important about that, I think, in reference to this conversation, is we share those very specifically and walk through those with our cohort members so that they hold us accountable, so that they have an opportunity to say to me, to call us up and say, all right, if we're talking popular change, I don't feel heard in this at all. This came down and no one asked me. And that's our opportunity to stop and say, oh, okay. Well, we might need to back up a little bit to make sure that we're not just talking about equity, but that we're practicing it and embodying it. I think when we talk about diversity, I'll just touch the other ones real quick. Diversity, I think, often is related to what we see in our eyes. And you're like, oh, look, it's a lot of different people in the room. We won, you know? And so we know that there's so many layers that we can move through that. Inclusion to me implies an invitation. Like, I want you to be included. And that still has a power differential in some ways, right? Who gets invited? This phrase that, Lord help me, I'm going to just drive into this idea. Who's at the table? Like, if we're moving past, I won't say moving past, because I think all these are important. But if we're talking about equity, then we're looking at inclusion is who's at the table. We're looking at where did the table come from? How are the workers that cut down the wood treated? What deforestation is happening? What are the other pieces? And if there's inequity in those, then you have to start from the beginning. You have to rethink the process and the structures and the systems at their base in order to actually enact equity in the field.
Awesome. See? Specialists. That was awesome. Okay, so we talked about these various specific approaches that's happening within these institutions and our distinguished panelists' work. But we're going to broaden this out a little bit and talk about what's happening in the field broadly. So in a recent report prepared by Holly Sitford and Alexis Frost of Helicon, which was published last November, Helicon asserts, and many of you are going to be like, mm-hmm, I already knew that number. I'm just going to say it now. But Helicon asserts that a very small percentages of foundation arts funding are directed towards addressing cultural equity. What does very small mean? Just 4% is targeted to organizations with a specific mission to serve communities of color, and just 3% overall goes to organizations with missions to serve lower income communities, LGBTQI communities, and the differently abled among geographically and rural communities. Toward the end of the report, Helicon spotlights some funder initiatives demonstrating bright spots to counter this trend, including Lane, which is supported by the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation. And so I'm going to start my question with Ella. Given the foundation's mentioning in this report, what do you think is driving what some are calling a movement in philanthropy? We're here, I don't know how many times equity is in the agenda today. A movement in philanthropy to prioritize greater accountability, greater equitable consciousness, greater equitable practices.
So we'll start small, right, with a small question. Actually, I would love to just get a reading from the audience on whether or not you think there is a movement. Yes or no?
A movement around what?
Equity.
There is a movement, yes.
Okay. I don't know if that's shared by everyone. I'm glad that we use the word movement instead of trend, because trend always means that somebody's left behind, and movement means that there's really a force behind it that may get us from A to B. I think a lot of things are driving it, and all the sociologists and culture workers and so many people have been trying to unpack this. I think the election of Barack Obama set something off in this country that reactivated something that has been there forever, since the beginning of the country. I really do feel that we had and are having perhaps a second civil war in a way, certainly ideologically. I think that time does its work, both in terms of making people forget, but people remembering. And back to Lane which clearly was named after Lane Harwell. Back to the Lane program, leveraging a network for equity, and Sage's amazing work on this with the Nonprofit Finance Fund. It's a commitment of an 8-year initiative. Okay, not 50 or 100 years. But, you know, things take time. And I think right now we're seeing some of the effects of America having forgotten and also remembering, and the remembering part is very, very important. I think also just the plain knowledge sharing. I mean, it's been said before, and we'll say it again, that the knowledge sharing and the access that has been afforded by now probably half of Americans who were born into the age of the internet has changed everything, really. And I think that this sort of empowerment of self-determined information is probably playing into this. I think it's also meant that people are chasing, it seems that people are chasing the future, you know. It's hard to catch up. But it also has sped up certain actions and strategies, certainly within the arts community, but I think probably in America in general, and we're sort of seeing this collision of that in a certain way right now. And I think, I don't know, it's hard to explain what informs awareness. Time, yes. Cataclysmic events, yes. The media, yes. All of these things. People talking with one another in a much more immediate way than they were ever able to now. Police with video cameras on them, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I think that awareness, it's a funny thing, you know. It can happen in a moment. It's called an epiphany. And it also can take a couple of hundred years. And so I think all of those things are at play here.
So Maurine, could you contribute to this conversation? I mean, I appreciate Ella asking the question, is there a movement? Because so very often we adopt language, we'd be like, yeah, it's a movement. This Occupy movement, this movement, this movement, and then things are still the same.
Yes, but right? It was very silent out there.
I know. I got to remind people, silence does not mean consent. So we really do want to hear what your thoughts on it. Maurine, what do you think? I mean, is there a movement? And if so, what are the indicators of such?
Well, I do think there's a movement, and I'll talk about the indicators, but first I want to just acknowledge that although the question is framed around a movement within philanthropy, philanthropy exists as part of a larger world, of course. And so this is embedded inside a global movement for equity that has been aided and abetted by technology, in fact. I think that the fact that social media is so prevalent in our world has allowed information to be disseminated much more thoroughly and rapidly, instantaneously in many instances, and where before ideas were certainly contagious, now we have a situation where both ideas and actions can be transmitted in much more compelling and powerful ways than they have been up to this point. I think, and I said this on the version of this panel that happened last year, but there is also just the sheer business case for it, which is to say demographics have changed in this country. No longer are we a country that is, we were never actually, but we had a notion of ourselves as monolithic in many ways, a majority white country with people of a certain socioeconomic class and so forth. Certainly our society today puts the lie to that. In addition to that, there are in fact the socioeconomic conditions in which people live. Lisa, you mentioned the Occupy movement a moment ago, and certainly that was one of the flashpoints where we had our attention drawn in very stark terms to the vast chasm between those at the top of the financial food chain and those at the bottom of the financial food chain. So in terms of the indicators, I think that we are starting to see individual philanthropic organizations and philanthropists move beyond asking questions to begin taking action. Someone in the previous panel about diversity on boards talked about the fact that a lot of lip service has been paid to the notion of quote unquote to diversity. But when the rubber hit the road in terms of plans, only 18% of these organizations had any concrete plans to address diversity, let alone inclusion or equity in their respective institutions. Now you are starting to see action take place. And so that is an indicator that there has been traction that has been gained. And we understand, if for, again, for no other reason than because of the business case, that there is no turning back. So in fact, that is one of the things to me that distinguishes this time from previous versions of this, when it might have been called multiculturalism or cultural diversity or whatever it might have been called in previous iterations.
So in the spirit of these actions that's happening right now, Hoong-Yi, can you share any meaningful, like direct and distinct changes that you're seeing happening in the field as a result, in addition to the
equitable movement, equitable kinesiology that I love. What else is happening broadly that you're seeing? Are there sub-movements? Are there sub-networks happening? What are your observations?
I can speak to that in a specific target segment that I think is has been especially challenging for all of us, and that's the millennials. I've been doing a lot of work with millennial populations and groups that work with millennial populations that are actively looking to become part of boards and figuring out what is the way in. And it was a surprise to me to know that of this particular generation, especially in New York City, a lot of them view boards as this big wall and they can't get in, and maybe they're not smart enough or whatever, but they have no identified means of access. And in working with a lot of these groups, I noticed that there is quite a lot of diversity, as you can imagine, this age range between 25 and 35. They are not C-level people. They are maybe upper middle management, but they certainly have years of experience in, and they have aspirations. And when I talk to groups that are actively looking to join boards, it is astonishing to me that they feel inadequate. And, you know, I said, well, can you define inadequate? What does that mean? You're smart, you're educated, you're working, you have an interest in the arts. What else do you need? And I think their perception also creates their barriers. And I thought that was an interesting observation for this particular group. Because in my mind, you know, I'm going to quote a man that I think is brilliant, and it's Dr. Manuel Pastor from California. And he speaks on diversity, and he's an ethnographic professor at, I think it's the University of Southern California or Stanford, or one of those,
UCLA.
And he said, his son is a rock musician, and he said to me, well, you know, he's out there making a life in the arts, and he's running into all of the problems that I speak about at all of these conventions. But he said, you know, look at the, demographics is my business. Guess what? In 10 years, they're going to be more them than us. So in a way, the market is going to actually dictate how a lot of these inequities in terms of access for practicing artists or media consumption or, you know, just how Americans consume and create culture is going to change, just the way Maurine said that America is changing. So in terms of how millennials can become more integrated into the future of our boards is a particular interest of mine. And I really believe that there are some organizations, like ivy.org is one of them. They actively have millennial clusters in many cities around the country, and they actively try to work with the local arts groups on the ground to integrate millennials to become junior board members. I think the junior committee of this organization is stunning. So thank you, Lane, for putting that together. I think it's the way of the future. I think that you have 24 hours, maybe 8 hours of the day that you're effective. For me, if I don't get my sleep, it's even less. But what are you going to fight? Are you going to fight the establishment, or are you going to maybe work towards the future? I believe that that's the way to go.
So Maurine aptly shared that, you know, this idea of equity isn't just in philanthropy, it has a global context. Another word that I would say is starting to trend, at least in my practice, is intersectionality, right? And so I'd like to ask the specialist to share with us her thoughts around how this notion and practice and consciousness of intersectionality is rooted and maybe even driving some equity, diversity, equity, inclusion practices.
Absolutely. The term intersectionality, in some ways I love, in other ways always makes me a little nervous, right? Because it can very easily turn into this mosh of all things just mashed together. So I think when we're using the frame intersectionality, we want to think about where does the word come from and who started using it. And Kimberly Crenshaw and the feminist movement in the 86 or so, really kind of coined the term intersectionality, and she was a student of Audre Lorde that talks about, you know, that it's not our differences that is the problem, it's our erasure of our differences that are the problem. So what intersectionality requires is a lean into complexity. Part of the reason it's near and dear to me is because the program I run, LANE, Leveraging a Network for Equity, serves arts organizations of color and geographically isolated arts organizations. So you're talking small, rural, often predominantly white communities, and you're talking communities of color all around the country. So we thought, well, you know, people are having similar challenges. While they come from different roots, we can create something that, you know, can support folks being healthy and keeping our ecosystem, our arts ecosystem, healthy. And last year, I referenced Ta-Nehisi Coates' A Case for Reparations, which was a seminal piece of reading that deeply informs how we think about where our arts communities are, arts communities of color are, and why some of the strategies that folks like to ask them to do just simply won't work, because that's not the history of the communities that they're in. But I realized earlier this year that we didn't have the same depth of analysis for our geographically isolated arts organizations. They were just sort of like, oh, and you too. So we had to take a moment and really dig into what's the clarity of our intersectional analysis. And that took us to meetings with the Center for Rural Strategies, reading Hillbilly Elegy, although people say that that's not really great anymore. and ultimately landed, again, intersectionality started from a justice framework, landed in the work of Miles Horton and Paulo Freire, the Poor People's Movement, with Dr. King and Fred Hampton and Unify Chicago, as a way to look at who has already been thinking about poor white communities and communities of color in the intersections. And so how can we bring those together with a clear political analysis and a clearer theory of change? And so when I think about intersectionality, it is the bringing together, but we also have to dig deep. We had to, and I would encourage others, to really dig deep into what is going on within those communities and not make any assumptions, and figure out what is the theory of change that works for both, knowing the root causes come from different places. And that's the road we make by walking.
Awesome. So before we open it up to the audience, so I'm going to remind you that if you do have burning questions, make them succinct, get them ready. But before we do that, I'm going to ask each of the panelists just to briefly and succinctly share, what do you think is happening in the future? Like, where is either philanthropy trending, or any area that is important to you? Where is it trending that's relevant to this conversation and to this audience? I'll start with you, Ella.
Well, we mentioned demographics earlier, and I think this is one of the factors that is inevitable. You know, even in the age of fake news, you can't ignore what is really right in front of you in your own neighborhood, in your own college or university campus, and so on. And so I think it was Maurine who mentioned this, but it can't be underestimated in terms of the influence that it's already obviously having in so many places. But this will inevitably continue, particularly as more and more people around the world become, unfortunately, more and more displaced by political and social and climatic events. So I think we better get prepared for that. I mean, somebody said, probably a lot of people said, you know, the future is right now, so except maybe it'll look a little different, right? So it's hard to predict exactly, obviously, what it's going to be, but that is one trend that we see being very, very obvious. I think, and I'm going to say this optimistically, that there are actions that are being taken. And I'll just give you two examples of organizations that are in situations that are at the foundation that at the top of my head today that bode well for the future. And one is that we support a program called the Intercultural Leadership Institute. And it's quite brilliant because these are organizations, it's PAI, it's, I'm gonna have to probably look, for the First People's Fund, NALOC, and Alternate Roots. So they come from different cultural histories, lineages, perspectives, different places across the United States. It's a beautiful thing. But they each represent of, by, and for their communities. But they decided to come together for a number of reasons most of which, you know, you're reciting in your head right now. But the way in which they have constructed values, practices around cohabitation, around sharing of resources, around building coalitions of the will, respect, is really, I think, what I would like to put as much oxygen around as possible for the future. And then very quickly, I'll say one thing that happened when I came to the foundation. Our vice president and the American Association of Museum Directors and several others, again, in coalition, got together, and they, just by looking around, the visual evidence that you were referring to earlier, Sage, about diversity, realized that the museum world was very undiverse at the top, right, at a certain level. So they decided to commission a study, and if you haven't read it, I highly recommend it, even though, you know, take an aspirin before. But it's an art museum staff demographic survey, and while it may not surprise you, it is rather shocking that 84% of the leadership is white, non-Hispanic white, and many other stats are in there. And that has circulated very, very widely, not only in the museum world, but all over the field. The good thing, of course, is that it is a piece of very visible research that has affected some of the organizational practices of organizations, and that's a good thing. Maybe I answered a little.
Thank you, Ella.
I'd like to speak about what my purview is on the grassroots level, and I'm really loving all of this information that I'm hearing from my colleagues on the panel from all different points in the atmosphere. On the grassroots level, I notice in our grant pools, for about 8 to 10 years, I used to know everybody coming in for a grant. I knew every artist. They were, you know, the usual suspects, and they were not diverse at all. They were glee clubs, they were oratorio societies, they were little string quartets, and they took place in what I call the tennis club communities of Queens. In the last few years, because of real estate and movement and, you know, whatever, we're noticing an incredible explosion in the kinds of artwork, the kinds of artists, the reasons it's forced us to change. One of the changes that we made, not because of any brilliance on my part or my board, or it was just sheer desperation because we really didn't know how to service these people as well as we could, was we said, we're going to take a certain part of what we do, and we're going to let you self-determine what you're going to do with it. And that turned into a social equity network. I don't know if Emily Berry's in the room, but she was one of our dancers, and she took that and ran with it, as did four or five others, and they created social equity networks that are self-generating on the ground. And I think that for the grantee level, and for us as a local grant maker, to be able to support that level of activity on the ground does something that makes you feel good, that you can, that I can actually take back to my board and say, guess what, they're doing this now. Maybe you'd like to cut a ribbon, you know, at one of these things. Maybe you'd like to, you know, show up and do stuff, you know, that gets you out there a little more with the actual artists that we are supporting. So it is something that is very intrinsic that happens when it is self-generated on the ground. I believe that there was a study done by LinkNet where they identified the four needs of artists. And the one, besides the material, the money, the health insurance, all of that, was validation, which is the trickiest one to actually wrap your head around, because what does that mean for that artist? Is it external, internal, you know, mainstream, within your community? But validation, to me, is the most important. And there is nothing more validating than saying to an artist, go and do this. What is it that's important to you? Go and gather, do stuff. You could use my space, I'll find parking, we'll get daycare. It's important. And to have that validation from us as a local arts council on that level can change the world. Emily's work is now in South Africa, in China. One of our other artists has reached many states doing her work from this initial impetus. And so I think that in addition to the funds and the support and the research and everything else, sometimes it's just that. It's just that permission or just that opening the door to the self and saying, it's important what you think and it's important what you believe. So just go do it.
Maurine?
So a couple things. One is a willingness to be uncomfortable. And the panel on diversity in boards, a couple people remarked, you know, these conversations are difficult and they can often be uncomfortable. And in the past, that could have been a gating item for deeper inquiry. So in other words, the moment you felt discomfort, you backed away and turned your gaze towards something else. And I think increasingly people are becoming willing to just stay in that discomfort for a little while and to understand that truly the only way through or to the other side of the discomfort is through it, in fact. And so, and I think related to that, there is an increasing recognition that we're not alone in occupying that space of uncertainty and discomfort. And we're finding allies who look like us and who look very different from us, who are taking the journey with us. Related to that, I see organizations really doing significant work to deepen their own analysis and critique, to define the problem very explicitly, and to develop and then implement courses of action. The MAP Fund is now working, taking the leadership in a year-long curriculum with a number of other re-granting organizations that the Duke Foundation supports, NEFA, TCG, Dance USA, among them, to take anti-racism training together. And then to apply that to looking at each of their panel processes to see where are the choke points in their panel processes that are informing certain inequitable outcomes on a repeated basis, and to work together in a study group, if as it were, to look at places to really shift that practice toward more equitable outcomes. So what I see is, in addition to being uncomfortable generally, because you know most people don't like to admit they don't know stuff, that makes us uncomfortable, right? A willingness to say, I don't know, I'm not sure, I need to find out. I have to run the risk of asking a dumb question. When that feels very, it feels very awkward to me. And then understanding that we need resources and that we can obtain those resources and we don't have to take on that line of endeavor on our own.
Sage?
So I think what's trending right now, what I see is this focus on systems, systemic racism and other oppressions, and a very clear analysis that connects to justice movements. I think we are in the midst of a movement, and what we're seeing looks a lot like organizing within the philanthropy field than I think we've seen historically. One of the ways that shows up is questions not that we're seeing programs and conversations that look at their funding pools or who's applying going, well, they need more technical assistance. That's why they're not applying. And what we're seeing now is where are systems actually inhibiting folks so that organizations are taking a look at themselves and reimagining their processes so that we're not asking folks to become something else, that we're not deifying a norm that people shouldn't need to fit into in order to have access to resources. But instead, we're looking at where our processes do not create enough space for folks to come authentically as they are and to be validated for the work that they do.
Awesome. And I would say where we don't have enough cultural competence to, right, to really understand different presentations, different forms, and how things are valued differently one community to another.
This is truer than true what you just said, Sage, I think, because I think also another thing that's happening is that people are speaking up more. They're actually saying what they need more. That, you know, a lot of walls are being broken down, and that's a very good thing. and also a willingness to define with more specificity, more content behind it, what the issues actually are. Yeah, I'm seeing that, definitely.
So it's hard to be on this Marley floor without moving. It's also hard to be on this Marley floor with shoes on. But I'm gonna like let that part go of my ingrained training. I wanna actually open this up to the audience. And I'm gonna succinct questions, I'm gonna start here.
This is not the 11th hour, is it? Or is something actually gonna be able to be effective at this time? If we go back and recognize this is such an old conversation, I'm with the Asian American Dance Theater from 1970s. I was with TAC, the Association of American Cultures, who's nationally active on this question in the 80s. And now we're with the CEG, Cultural Equity Group in New York City, that has been working for the last 7 years on this question and had a conference in April last year. It's growing, but now the news is that we have given up. We have given up and we've decided that we've got to work outside of the system. And so a group of us have gotten together and we've now put out a people's cultural plan. And the first page was introduced to the city council hearing just last week. And the other pages will be coming out shortly, and before April, we expect a full discussion. And so I think we are trying to propose more drastic measures that the community, small groups like mine and many others, are demanding. We hope that this is not news to all of you. We hope that it will permeate the whole discussion in the city of New York and beyond. Thank you. And so the question is, in the 11th hour, what can we really hope to accomplish?
So one of you. In the 11th hour, what can we really hope to accomplish?
I'm not sure it's the 11th hour. I think that's my question. I haven't been in the space as long or working on it as long. I recognize my elders. I was raised right. But I think that history moves, and what we're looking at now, I think, is more of an intellectual complexity, right? That I love what you're doing, because it's strategies and movements are never one way. This idea of like change happens in only one direction or with only one strategy isn't real, right? Like that's the false narrative of how change happens. There's some charismatic leader, there's one person, or there's one direction, and that's just absolutely false. And so when we move beyond the binaries and there's this sort of inside-out strategy, there are communities that are doing their work, that are eschewing the system and the state, and like, this is how we're gonna go. And there are simultaneously folks working within institutions and organizations to shift them. That's where you get this this nexus that I think we're in right now. And I have a friend who will call it the radical point of tension of like a bird coming out of an egg. It's like that last push. If you reference the 11th hour, that's what this 11th hour feels like to me. These things are coming together simultaneously. We're intersecting and we're making that last push through the egg.
Anyone else there? So, then question, and I hate to take this down to a nuts and bolts basis, but we're talking about diversity and equity and inclusion in philanthropy, but we've only been talking about institutional philanthropy. 71% of giving in America is individual, and if we're really trying to help specifically, culturally specific organizations, that's where the gap is biggest, there and in volunteer leadership. What, from where you're sitting, where you've already done so much as thought leaders and as funding leaders, what can you do to help turn some sparks into flames here?
Sure. I think that's a great question. And you're right. But I think one of the things to recognize is that currency is different for contributions in different communities. And one of the things that you'll find looking back at old studies is that African American and Latinx communities, for example, count their volunteer time as valuable as opposed to writing checks. But that in fact, when you look at it per capita, they are as or more generous than white contributors are. And while I think that we have only been talking about institutional funding up to this point. The truth is that those institutional funders and those individuals who are giving to institutions are more likely to give to other organizations because they're already doing it. And so I think that those of us who are within philanthropic institutions can encourage our institutions to look at new recipients of support and new institutional partners. I think for cultural organizations that are large budget organizations, there is work that can be done within those boards of directors to ask them to look at other recipients of support. And that is an asset that often goes untapped. I think we have a tendency when we run these cultural organizations to guard pretty jealously our supporters and to think we need to keep hold of this because we need to do fill in the blank, the thing that we need to do. And I think that that can sometimes leave us to miss things because often folks aren't going to take money away from you to give to another organization, but will figure out a way to support both things. So we can provide very significant and powerful levers with those relationships that we already have with individual donors to get them, to introduce them to other worthy organizations. And too often we don't do that, I think.
One more question.
Thank you. In the definitions of diversity that philanthropic organizations use, disability is sometimes included and sometimes not included. And I noted that grant makers for the arts in the arts includes ableism as a process of exclusion. What do you think, rather than just say what your organization does, what do you think the tensions are that keep it in or exclude disability from being not only named, because sometimes it's named, but really given the weight that would be necessary for attention to be paid to that constituency group and that form of art?
Hoonley or Ella, would you like to respond?
Simi, I think that in inherent in your question is a defensive stance that, you know, in that you have to fight to be in the conversation. So I think that a lot of the reasons why this is because people have a greater discomfort with disability. They're as uncomfortable as they are with race and everything else, you throw disability in as well, and that forces the work that you do as a coalition to advocate for the inclusion of disability in the language and in the policies, it's an external perception, another layer, a barrier. So I think that it is a semantic battle as well as an intrinsic battle that lies within a cultural discomfort or norm where this society prides itself on being thin and young, and you know there's a lot of things that the media enforces, so that in terms of being inclusive of disability forces us to sort of face our own mortality and also to face the fact that we are more multifaceted than what we see on People magazine or in the movies. And those are other battlegrounds where the societal values of what we are as an American society are actually reinforced over and over and over again. So I'm really glad to see like the Gap has actually had ads with people of all colors, stripes, with disabilities, not disabilities, and they are one of the forefront of a few manufacturers and businesses that are actually opening their platforms to actually have the face of disability, of just that segment of our population to be included in the norm. Or the visual norm that we see, but I do think that it is it's our own inability or our own oversights in being able to include that in the language. And I'm very happy that ableism was part of the statement of GIA, but I don't think that it appears often enough. And so whether or not that is an issue that we have to take to that level on the level of GIA and have it really be the spokesperson and the trumpeter for that, in addition to all of the work that's been done on the local level. It is something that I see with disappointment, as probably you do as well, that it is not as prevalent as we'd like to have it be. And I also know, just from coming from a...
Hoong-Yi, I'd love, as we're in our last 7 seconds, to have Ella, if I just wanted to know if you wanted to respond to that or any final words that you'd like to say.
I could ask a question.
Okay, great.
Of all of
Thank
us,
you.
Actually. And that would yes. be that, very quickly, I went to a performance, maybe some of you were there, Toshi Regan, up at Harlem Stage, had a prominent role in Michel Ndegicello's piece on James Baldwin, right? And it was done almost like a church service in the round. And at a certain point in the show, she said, and this was right after the election, she said, okay, everybody, I'm going to stop everything. Do you have a plan? And half the audience sort of went, uh-oh, I really don't have a plan. And others said, yes, Costa Rica, and whatever it was, they threw out what their reaction was going to be. And you can imagine there was great unanimity within the crowd. And then she said, in only the way that Toshi can do that, she said, I have to introduce the people who don't have a plan to the people who do have a plan. You have to get to know one another. And my question is, do you have a plan? Do we have a plan? We can't predict exactly what's going to happen, but we have to, and I think we all are, creating different scenarios. And it doesn't mean that there has to be one thing, that there have to be five things that everybody agrees about as strategy in this movement, but maybe one thing. And the power of that is considerable. So
as you ruminate,
question,
as you ruminate on that rhetorical question plan, in the interest of time, you ruminate on that. Just 2 points of information. One, I want to ask Sage to talk about Lane, and then there was a request, dear sir, for you to share where people can find the people's plan that you referenced. So, Sage, and then
really quickly following up on Ella, people who don't have a plan who might be looking for someone who does. We are putting out our first piece of collateral information around Lane. You all get this hot off the presses. And we decided not to wait for 8 years to share like the results, but we're going to share our thinking as we're moving and the things we shift, because that is also about the real story of change and transformation, that we learn, we pivot, we grow. And so here's just a brief thing that folks can have, take with you about some of the cornerstones of Lane. And on the back is a link to a Prezi that we update regularly with different resources, different questions we're thinking about, because we're looking to really grow a community of folks who are thinking about these things and talking about these folks. So get one of these for me before you go.
We don't have an exact place, but where the link is at We Create New York City. That's one link from in Twitter's. We Create New York City. The other way is you can contact me, because the first page is now public. The four other pages are still being written by a whole group of people. So if you reach me, that's R Lee, L-E-E, at Art Spiral, ARTSPIRAL.org.
And with that, I say thank you so very
much.
Thank
you, Lisa.
Thank you, panelists.